Welcome everybody here to your broadcast of the joinDOTA MLG Pro League. It is the European qualifiers, and we're trying to find out which team is capable of going up against BBC to play off for one of the positions at X Games, which is the MLG joinDOTA Pro League LAN finals in America later on in like a month's time, so it's not far off. The draft's already underway. We had ourselves a couple of fun little problems with audio, and now I'm going to cross my fingers and basically go YOLO style to see how does Blaze sound. How do you sound, Blaze?
Well, hopefully pretty good. I've got a lot of ideas about this matchup, so I'd like to have them coming in loud and clear.
And they are coming in loud and clear. You're good, man. You're good. And excellent. Quality audio excellent. As well. Love it.
Good stuff. So, yeah, I was actually casting Four Anchors and Sea Captain a little bit earlier, and just the other day, they were pulling out some really cool strats. I mean, it wasn't really hardcore new meta, nothing that's been extensively buffed in 6.4, but just the minor tweak here, like adding a lone druid in their carry position for Matumbo Man. You'd never think, like, with what all the different carries that he plays and all the aggression that he brings, that'd be really good at just sitting back, farming, and pushing. But really, when they get that chin online for Boogie, they're able to do so much as far as opening up the map goes. So I'm excited to see their tempo as it comes into game one.
Yeah, I'm interested to see it too. I haven't cast a 4ASC match in a very long time. The only team which actually was studying up a lot more recently was Alliance. And obviously, it's difficult to really pull anything out of Alliances with their recent games. They did play in the recent ESL competition over the weekend, but as the Alliance guys admitted themselves, they had no preparation. They didn't have any time for the new patch. Mad was away over on holidays, so he wasn't ready to come in as well. So it was problematic no matter how we looked at it, and no matter how Alliance looked at it. And they just tried to play the heroes that were the most comfortable with. And it looks to be like we're going down exactly the same road for the draft for them.
Yeah, for the most part. So with the Admiral Bulldog having the Nature's Prophet in his hands, I did get to witness this morning the Aghanim Scepter and what that brought to the table as far as the whole Treant spawning. And it wasn't really microed very well because the player that was playing him wasn't a very experienced Furion player. FY usually plays random supports and not even the micro-intensive ones. So obviously Bulldog, he's much more micro-centric. He's much more looking to capitalize on any kind of creature they can summon up, and I actually think that he probably will look for Aghanim Scepter as a core item, maybe not in as his like first pickup, but definitely looking at maybe like a third or a fourth. It's really strong, especially I noticed this morning, I don't know if it counts as a bug or anything, but if you're up against an Illusion hero and you last hit them, it counts as the greater Treant, three times health, three times damage, and that's pretty powerful in my mind. It seems almost borderline broken against heroes like Phantom Lancer, maybe a Naga or a TB.
See, I was discussing this the other day with Wagger, in fact, about the whole Nature's Prophet, and it's and mainly the Aghanim Scepter upgrade, and I kept looking at it, because I'm a big Prophet fan, I'm a big believer in Nature's Prophet, I'm loving the fact that Split Push is back in the world of Dota now, at least as strong as it is, but the problem I feel is that the Treants don't add enough presence with just a couple of them there. If you go into this whole rat game and waiting till later, hell yes, get yourself an Aghanim Scepter. It's going to push out all the lanes without any risk to your primary hero. But the problem you have is that if it's not that type of game and you got easy heroes like a Tiny or someone else that can just mop up the Treants, you're just ending up feeding more gold and CS over to the enemy team. They've got more money to play with, which, with now the fact that the supports have better transition items into the later portion of the game, means that, it's actually worth a hell of a lot more now. So that's the only concern I've got with the Prophet, that if you cannot control the micro, which is difficult to do too, because they summon out of the units you kill, keeping track of all of those and instantly giving them a command is not simple. I don't know if you know of any micro ways, as in like hotkeys, that help with this situation. That's one thing I don't know.
Well, the thing that I could think of is if you're trying to get them all just to assault the enemy base, then what you can just do is a unified unit order and A-click the fountain, essentially. And if they're on the enemy side of the map, if they're on the offensive, then they will just kind of go that direction. Go down the lane, top lane, mid lane, bottom lane, just go for the towers and just attack anything that's in between, really. So that seems like the best way to do it for when you have all that all at once is just A-click the fountain, and they'll be marching that direction. Doesn't work for if they spawn from the jungle, if you have wards up and you last hit some neutral creeps, but in general for lane creeps, that'll probably be the most efficient way to do it. And, I mean, they're going to be stampeding around, perhaps, with the Sentinel Warner picked up here. I think the global presence is going to be pretty huge here. I mean, you're always going to have that Stampede available. Aghanim Scepter probably going to be Centaur's second item. That's an item that you can reliably say is pretty much core on the Centaur every game. If not the second item, if you need to get a BKB or a pipe, then you delay it to your third, but you're still going to see it, and it's still very powerful.
We got to see it for a very fraction of a moment during our last game we were casting. And when I say a fraction of a moment, the game was over. He bought an Aghanim Scepter and triggered it. That was basically all we got. The transitioning to get it to the second item, like, it really, really has to be worth it. Over something like having a Blink Dagger and a Four Staff, more high maneuverability items, like, I'm still not a believer yet, but I'm waiting for the game blaze that makes me a believer. 10 seconds
remaining. Well, we'll have to see. This one might very well be it. I think Shadowfiend, obviously, with his current toolkit, he's very offensive, he's very squishy, and he can be burst down so hard by heroes like a Storm, Lina, Beastmaster. Like, the Shadowfiend, if he's not well protected, is going to be food for four anchors in general. So I think that Centaur covering him, at least with a Blink Dagger, is going to be very important. But if we see that Ag Scepter, we might see the table turned a bit, and SF being able to survive through all that nuke damage. But we are going to be seeing Mutombo on the Juggernaut here, so Trixie, Offlane, Beastmaster, pretty standard, and then of course the Storm Spirit will be taken to the mid lane. So support Lina still pretty good, but I'm not sure how good it'll be against Admiral Bulldog's micro. We'll have to see.
Yeah, it's always going to be fun for Lina trying to get rid of all of these trains that just harass you back out, but for me, I'm loving the Alliance lane just for stability more than anything else. The jungle, Pycat, obviously is going to be able to have free reign if that one, just being able to go in there. I'm not saying he's a jungle SF. I'm just saying he can move down and flash farm those two easy camps, which Lion and Dazzle can take care of, and everything else just comes into lane security. Watching Centaur taking up the role of Loader, though, that's going to be fun for me. This is that moment when I believe a little bit stronger about, like, that whole second 10 seconds remaining. Item Aghanim Scepter over on the Centaur after he gets a Blink Dagger. I can understand that one, remaining. But at the same time, I'm wondering if Loader doesn't really believe in that. This team hasn't had a lot of time to really practice with it, so they may just go into the more standard style of build, like what they feel comfortable with more than anything else.
If you think about it, the Centaur here is just essentially replacing the Slaughter as far as an option for their draft. Like, Dazzle, Shadowfiend, adding in the Slaughter would be the standard thing with the amplified damage, but they seem to think they're going to get even more utility out of the Centaur if he gets good farm, good momentum. So I think that he's going to be able to kind of build himself up pretty quickly. He doesn't really mind the boar harassment too much. He'll return some of the damage against the boar and just in general keep on doing what he's doing. But yeah, the blink timing is going to be curious, so how quickly he can get it out and how active he can be with it against certain heroes. Because like, the Storm Spirit should be able to ball before you get the jump and hoof stomp on him, but there are other heroes that are much more vulnerable.
Aggressive movement from Alliance. They're trying to make sure that Chan can't do anything with these camps, or at least if he does do anything, he's being watched like a hawk. And using the treant movement beforehand means they're not going to get caught out. So let's just run through our lanes nice and quickly to see who's going to be where. So it will be Loader, the safe lane Centaur, going up against Trixie's Beastmaster. And towards the middle lane is Nymphy's Storm Spirit, who has... Okay, is that just a headpiece or is something broken with his head? This is a rogue's braid. Looks a little bit broken. But he'll be the mid Storm Spirit. The top lane is actually where we're going to find, well, no engagement. Alliance are too well positioned for this. But it's going to be, sorry, Pike at the start with going to be that other mid contester up against the Storm Spirit. RK roaming around with the Lion. RK with the Dazzle. Lion played up by Mad. And that leaves the offlaner Admiral Bulldog, who's up against the defensive lane with Mutombamon. He's the Juggernaut with Varlix, the Lina, Boogie, the Chen into the jungle. And that wraps up our lanes, Blaze.
Looking at the bottom lane. Yeah, actually, they're going to be trying to put pressure up early on to Nymphy here. Maybe just a couple of poison touches and some right clicks, but they want to at least get Pycat's Souls up to like 4 or 5 so they can actually last hit. Before that, like, he has no control of the lane, and the overload is going to be overwhelming that last hit competition between the Shadowfiend and the Storm. But eventually, I think Ake will rotate away. We'll see how well he feels like he can contribute on the other lanes. But actually thought it was interesting what they did for the bottom room play. Trixie had the double boar up, so he summons one very early, then has two up at the same time. And he was actually able to pressure Loda off the rune. They got it for Nymphy, and then Loda even was forced to use his first hoof stomp, so a little while before he can even use his second stun here up against Trixie. But it should come out about the same time as level 2 for Lion, and that's when Trixie has to play scared.
Then again, Trizzy can just do what he keeps doing. You talked about his ball micro before. He's managed to block up that pull point, that side camp, multiple times now just by putting the ball over there. So
yeah, I tried to do it with the Hawk, but I think Mad actually Earth spiked it, so they took care of that first and foremost. But he's still doing a really good job making sure that Mad can't get what he wants out of the lane.
And RK is not a happy man here in the mid. Neither is Pycat. He keeps getting harassed. We've got this Sada from behind, the soaring out blast at him all the time. He's managed to at least find 8 souls, so the CS is going to start to increase a lot quicker. Let's make that 9 with the denial. But the Storm Spirit's getting up in their faces, and on top lane too, it's the same kind of thing. Matumbaman as well as Valix trying to mop up these creep waves as quick as they can and just limit the area that Admiral Bulldog has to use. The downside they have is the fact that Valix as well as Matumbaman are in so deep right now. Once they use the Light Striker raid, there's no more control factors over on Bulldog. And he saw that and instantly just started beating into them. Radiant's top tower
is under attack. Damn. I'm really wondering when Boogie's going to start building up for himself, because for right now he is obviously, like you said, harassing with the Satyr in the mid, but that's out of mana now, and Chen is still sitting barely not even level 2, so he's gotten a stack on the eastern side that may be for Storm, that may be just so he has access to better creeps, but he's not going to have like a Wildling Ripper to AoE that down or anything. He's going to have to wait for the Storm to rotate and get experience off of that, and that's probably where he gets about level 6 for his Hand of God, about like 5 minutes from now. But for now, he'll stack that up, and he'll keep on trying to find creeps that can do things with, and obviously the Dark Troll Summoner on the western side is a good spawn for him, and either one of the Centaur or Hellbear he might still kind of take from that stack and start using elsewhere, but yeah, he's kind of focused on himself a little bit. If you build up your Chen early on, he's actually going to be able to do a lot more with the new Holy Persuasion scaling. Getting to level 3 and level 5 are really good for Chen, and of course, getting to 7 eventually will be really nice for him. So we'll see how many creeps it takes for him to actually feel confident to gank the other lanes.
Not 100% certain why 4ASC need a pause, but the vast one anyway. So if you've just tuned in, I know a lot of people were watching a lot of great Dota, which is on tonight. So if you have just tuned in, let me bring you back up to speed for where we're at. You can check out all the details you want over on joindota.com. All you got to do is just go to the Leagues tab, and you'll see the big JD MLG Pro League button, which you can hit there. And that'll take you to the current season with the whole rundown, with the North American qualifiers, the Southeast Asian qualifiers, which ended recently. We've already managed to have our first team qualify for the X Games LAN Finals. That's going to be Team Malaysia, who are qualified over MVP Hot 6 in a 2-1 best of 3. And we're looking for 3 teams to come out from the European division. So at the moment, there's a battle scheduled between NIP as well as Virtus Pro. That game will be happening on the 13th of this month. And the winner of this game will play up against BBC. The winner of those two series will end up going directly through to X Games. And the losers drop down to the lower bracket finals. And we'll have that battle out for the final position coming out from the European division. So obviously, you want to take the quick road to the finals. And if you win this best of 3, win one more up against BBC, and you're going to America, all expenses paid, thanks to MLG.
Yeah, really cool stuff. So obviously a lot on the line here, and both teams are kind of giving it their all right now. I would definitely say like they're contributing a lot on all the different lanes, but overall I still think like 4AC are pretty happy with their start here. The fact that Storm is going to get built up so quickly is a huge aspect to their team lineup. Nemphy seems to be kind of the crux of their lineup as far as building his momentum. Doing pretty good in the mid, and he's going to do really well farming up the jungle too if Boogie allows him to. So maybe even going to see a gank on that Shadow Fiend soon with the Smoke of Deceit from the Chen. And if that succeeds, then they're going to build a lot of momentum, which will make up for what they're losing down bottom. Since Ake rotated, they've been able to start pulling, getting the Beastmaster further and further back under tower, and he's going to have to fall back to maybe a stacking Ancients and that kind of thing. He's not really going to have much more contention in the lane.
I'm actually surprised he hasn't started stacking up the Ancients already. So we're now 3.5 minutes in, and most of his ball is, like, all of his mana he's committed and summons to controlling up the support heroes, trying to stay as close in as he can. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, like 3.5 levels on the Beastmaster I think anyone's ever going to be sad about, but at the same time, the ability to flash farm over on the Ancients is just absolutely stupendous for a Beastmaster. That's where you get your surprise level 6, and you could potentially catch out Alliance a lot more at that point.
The interesting thing for Trixie's Beastmaster is he always goes for the same skill build, and it doesn't really prioritize Wild Axes. It's 1-4-1-1, so he gets the max call as far as Hawk and Boar. They're really powerful summons, but he won't really be able to tap into those Ancients until later. So he still stacks them, but it's much more reserved. It's like a 12 to 15 minute timing where he starts farming that. And he just really likes to emphasize the extra vision from the Hawk and the extra slowing and fighting potential with the boar. So it's definitely a different approach, but he's very consistent about it. Always goes that, almost always goes Necronomicon, and just kind of gets this whole zoo army that Alliance has trouble dealing with, perhaps.
I'm wondering if Alliance will even start caring about Necros later on. And is that really the build you want to see coming out from Trixie? To actually go for the Necros? I know what he does, but like, what exactly are we wanting to see from him? What's the best timing up against the Alliance heroes? Oh, hello.
Oh, Bulldog.
Yep, comes in. Already got that Sprout leveled up. Remember, it takes even longer before it dissipates, but it doesn't matter when he summons Nutrients. Body blocks him up. And Loader will get the first part as he double edges through the Beastmaster. And this is where we start getting not the Rat lineup, but the Force Pushed lineup. That's a level 2 Treant, so they can do a lot of damage to this tier 1 tower now.
However, up top, we're going to see some pressure come out as well. No Basilius Aura, but they do have the Healing Ward and a big creeps to use it. So they get the Wildwing Armor Aura, they get the Healing Ward. They should be actually able to push this even faster. And Alliance don't really have good heroes to rotate it. Like, maybe when Nature Prophet's level 6, he can kind of gradually counter push while farming. But in this situation, they have no contest at the tier 1. They'll have to draw the line at the tier 2.
The only choice they really have is like RK Shadow Waving from range, but without his creep wave there, that doesn't do much.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't think Alliance is still too sad about this. It's not a bad start for them. They find their first blood in the offlaner. They know SF is just skyrocketing up in farm. If they can control, okay, Nemphy, when he pops two raises to the face. If they can control his initial jump, like his initiation, then I think they're okay with it. They know the Juggernaut is powerful. I know Loader's got a crap ton of experience on this hero, but they also know Juggernaut was recently nerfed with his Omni Slash. So there's no more of these stuns that are gonna go, that's gonna pierce through the magic community with the first hit. It's a little bit more, yeah, you can freely move. I say freely move, you can slightly more freely move up against the Juggernaut.
Yeah, definitely. Grave TP is a really reliable option now. So, I mean, you have the natural teleport of Nature's Prophet, or you have the TP scrolls from anybody else. And if you have the Shallow Grave, the only people that are going to stop you is if they commit the Roar or have the Storm or Lina coming in. So, yeah, a lot of potential for them to kind of move a lot more on the map and farm a little bit more aggressively against him without reservations. But, yeah, interesting thing is that now Trixie has kind of taken the jungle a little bit. He goes with the boars, farms up the Dire Jungle since he doesn't feel safe down bottom with the amount of pressure they're amassing. So, he's going to kind of build himself up slowly, but in the end, it still seems like it's the Storm that they want to do the most with. Test of Faith home to refill and refuel, and then he's probably going to be looking at the Ancient Stacks. Actually, the Wildwing's going to find it, so Bogey's just going to kind of do it yourself, farm up to level 6, and Trixie will get a piece of that action too with the experience.
Yeah, and this will push him over, actually get him all the way over level 5 when he's splitting it with the Chen. But either way, it's very nice. I'm still very concerned about Nemphy. He took two shadow raises to the face again and drops down so low, and he's expending so many of his bottle charges just to keep his life up and not to spam out mana, not to spam out these overcharge attacks with the Static Remnant to trigger it all. Like, it's just not happening. So we're now 7 minutes in. The game has been fairly passive for the start of this, but it's what both teams have planned for. It's what both teams are very happy with. But the first team to hit their timing, which still for me is Alliance.
Yeah.
Because you've got your extra damage across the field. If Lion had level 6 at the moment, which he's leeching off the bottom lane, then for ASE, I don't believe they can actually fight. Any initiation is going to be countered by the Centaur, and potential burst damage from Wrath of Nature and Finger of Death is going to kill off most of your other heroes.
Yeah, and the Blink Tiger timing is awesome for Loda, actually, just able to move forward. Obviously, he got the first blood, so it certainly helps, but just at this point, having the Blink Tiger at nearly 9 minutes, just really good for the Centaur that also went for the Tranquils, and they're going to put some direct damage into this tower. Dragon Slayer or not, they're going to be able to really just hurt this, bring this thing down very quickly. We're going to see fortifications traded initially, but yeah, I could see right now, like, unless there's a really, really good initiative for ASC. They just don't have the ultis to fight this off. They don't have the Aurora, they don't have the Hand of God. They'll try to just slowly counter push it out, but in the end it's going to be pushing the deny range, and I think they're going to fight for it.
Well, I don't think 4SC need to. I think they can, yeah, just play from range, throw out the Slave, throw out the Axes, keep them off the towers. And in the meantime, our Tupperman's getting a lot bigger on the top. Nephi's finding this much-needed farm in the middle, because he's trying to keep up with the SF. More importantly, just get to his initiating item. Speaking of that, it looks like Trixie initiated on the bottom lane. The extra stun's there from Matt. And it was loaded with the Stampede and Blink Dagger that caught him off guard. Which is funny, because he came directly over the top of that Hawk. know if the Hulk was in position in time, but either way, that's another kill against Trixie.
Yeah, good find there. Just, I mean, there's such a long range of initiation with the Stampede plus Blink Dagger, and Lodi uses it pretty nicely there. Finger of Death now available on the Alliance, but I would not be surprised to see them smoke up with him very shortly. They have Nature's Prophet to teleport in anywhere. They have Mad's Finger, so yeah, they can drop somebody down pretty quickly if they can just find that smoke kill.
What type of build are you thinking about for Admiral Bulldog? Are you wanting a fighting kind of build or a pushing kind of build?
I think Orchid would be pretty good. Depends on the Storm build, obviously, but if you can get a Silence out against Storm Spirit, there's really not that good of a response for 4AC. They don't have really defensive support so much as offensive ones, and the Hand of God is the only help he's going to get.
What about the new Silver Edge?
Yeah, I could see that as like a third or fourth item, actually, definitely. I mean, the passives that you're negating aren't that great, but you're doing so much burst damage, and you get that extra bump up of durability yourself. I could see it as a pretty valuable pickup.
Jump up on top lane. Admiral Bulldog is going to die to Nemphy. Nice pickup. Storm Spear is the perfect pickup against Nature's Prophet. The reason why I'm thinking Silver Edge is I'm thinking about anything which allows him to escape from Storm Spirit when he jumps in. Admiral Bulldog used to go for like Blink Daggers and with the Maelstrom. I know that was the build he tried to do when he tried to bring back the Nature's Prophet. Pycat, you're up very, very far. Roar's gonna come in, and the Light Striker Ray, and the Laguna Blade. One charges and that's it. Like, there's no way he's gonna survive that. Get a little greedy up against the creep wave and had no vision of the high ground. So just free gold coming the way of 4ASC.
Yeah, I think that he was going to be relying on the Stampede, and it just didn't come out in time, and he was just too far forward by far, so they were able to pick him up pretty quickly, but looks like they still want to do something to this tower. They really want that healing ward, but it's got still quite a bit of movement speed, even in spite of its nerf, and it looks like they'll at least push them back for the moment, but really looking for Lota's next play. I mean, he only has one spell, so he has to choose carefully, but if he can get the jump in with both spells as he wastes just a few more seconds here, that's going to enable them to actually initiate from the flank and find a great opportunity.
Well, here they come. Remember, no vision on the high ground. It's either Dire Jungle. So a lot of it comes up to Lota getting that jump, and he's right on top of Boogie. There it is. Hoofstomp, Finger of Death. They wanted a kill, and they wanted it quickly. Even the Wrath of Nature was coming in. But that's important for them. They take out the Chen, which means they can take the Tier 1 tower, and that was their only objective here.
And actually find it interesting that Nemphy's going to be going for an Orchid of his own. I mean, obviously that's been a common item for Storm for a very long time, but more recently we've been seeing items such as the Bloodstone as well as the Yule Scepter actually become much more popular as defensive items for the Storm. But he sees that Admiral Bulldog is building a very fast Orchid, and he's still going to go for one himself. If it gives him kill opportunities against the Dazzle, great, but if he ends up falling as a result of it, he's going to be regretting it.
Trixie is actually a little bit of trouble recently. I was thinking that's the reason why Alliance is moving in. They just took out both the Hawks, so there was no way for 4ASC to have like direct vision inside the pit. There's no reason for them to also risk trying to take Roshan. At this point, they wait for it. Battle 4AFC and get more than just a kill on a Chen before they can do it. But actually, it looks like they're pinging out to go to the Tier 2 tower on bottom lane. They don't really have a lot of jump power yet. Mad's really close to that Blink Dagger on the Lion. But once they get that, getting these initial pickoffs is so easy. And with the 4-staff on the Centaur, they can just keep playing the positional game too.
Yeah, they're going to get this ward either on the high ground, watching over the Ancients, or maybe a little bit deeper into the jungle here, but getting that kind of intel is going to be amazing for this bottom lane pressure, making sure Matumbo Man isn't freely farming, that kind of stuff. Because I would say Alliance are pretty kill-fueled right now. With all these ultimates having all this damage output, they really want to find kills so that everybody can benefit as a whole. Like, Ake could actually do a lot of work with a couple of items like Urn of Shadows, and then getting like a Medallion of Courage that turns into a Solar Crest. Like, that alone enables this hero to do so much. So they really do want everybody to prosper. But we're going to see an attempted denial on mid that goes awry, and the Chen Creeps will finish it off.
Yeah, Admiral Bulldog just missing up the timing there. He thought the Centaur would attack normally, and if it did, he would have been fine. But just nice little stutter in the attack from Boogie. Means that Admiral Bulldog screws it up, and the maximum amount of gold comes the way of 4ASC.
Yeah, and we just see on the gold graph, I mean, what was once a 1,500 lead for Alliance does dip down a decent bit here as 4-Rankers start to kind of take enemy territory back a little bit. So, I mean, we're seeing Matumbo Man build up quickly. The Mask of Medicine to Yasha is no surprise here, but just in general, the fact that the Storm's going to be able to pick up his Orchid pretty quick I think that they could start fighting back soon. Like, they've been on the defensive almost this entire game, but I actually think that they're going to be starting to build momentum now for themselves, and it's going to be on Alliance's blink usage to respond to that.
Well, here's the time to do it. 4ASC, 4-man smoke up with the Chen Army. Centaur, Hellbear, as well as the Alpha Wolf, so they've got the damage they're looking to get. Just on a hell of a lot of control. In fact, they're going to go in for Roshan instead. They can drop the level 1 healing ward, but this one little Treant walks in, reveals the whole thing that's happening, and now Alliance have the choice. And in fact, 4AFC make the choice before Alliance can. They're getting the hell out of there.
Yeah, I actually thought that they would actually just put Mutomo Man in the pit and then have four people all on the outside, kind of waiting for them to go into the river, kind of waiting for them to engage. And if you have the kind of a concave here, then you'd be able to engage really hard once they go in just to stop the quote-unquote solo juggernaut, and then you kind of jump in. But in this case, they don't do the play where you go for a two-man gank. Instead, they're going to be initiated upon.
It's a Centaur ulti up. They find Boogie in the tree lines. He had no Hannah God. He had nothing else to really get. The Finger of Death dropping Trixie down. Admiral Bulldog, they've got to get themselves out of these tree lines. Finally, they're able to do so. The tree line was kind of killed off by the summonings. Before AOC just bailed out. There wasn't enough mana for an Omnislash even for the Juggernaut. He just doesn't have anything. And Alliance, this time, they will commit and take out Roshan. The Hawk is watching for them.
Yeah, they'd love to contest it, but I just don't see how. I mean, it would have to be a really long jump from the Storm Spirit to at least go for the snipe. I mean, the Radiant Observer Ward doesn't see him right now, so I think they'll just go for a steal with that Hawk Vision and kind of try to take it from there.
Well, I'm waiting for Arcade to also trigger this initial weave, which he hasn't done yet. Here comes Storm Spirit, killed by the Radiant. Oh. SF got the Aegis to the Immortal, and Nemphy, he's in a lot of trouble. Didn't have enough mana to jump back out again. Now, but Tumberman, he arrives at the fight once again with not enough mana to let off the Omni Slash. The Lifestriker Ray is keeping Loader and RK at bay for now. But it also means that Varlix is overextended by doing so. So they double edge him and attack him down. In fact, they held onto the double edge. Loader was already low enough. So not only do Alliance take Roshan, but they also take two of four AFC with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, really good coverage from Loader there. When Roshan was falling, the last hit coming through, he had the Hoof Stomp in the air to stun the Storm if he tried to go for the jump play. They get the Aegis on the Shadow Fiend. They keep that intact. He's got a mechanism as well. So if he just follows through with, like, a Black King bar, he's in a very great position where he can just use his offensive abilities while still being completely secure. With the Dazzle, the mechanism behind him, and an item like a Black King bar, he'd just be large and in charge and able to walk right into high ground, honestly. At this stage in the game, for us, he can only do so much. But let's see Volix try to defend it out here. Not seeing any blinkers just yet, but Effing Mad does find a Hawk, and that will be kind of securing this tier 2, I think.
They saw that Hawk come into position because of the ward on the high ground. Admiral Bulldog did get that Orchid you're talking about, so Storm Spirit, even if he does have mana and he jumps in, he's nowhere near having a BKB. And he's definitely not going for that little semi-Yule Scepter we saw in the old patch for Storm Spirits. There's no way to dispel that silence either.
Yeah. I feel that might be causing them some real issues. Unless the Test of Faith play from Boogie is really good, Nemphy's going to die a couple times with this Orchid. He just doesn't have the items to respond to it. And he naturally just has to go aggressive. Like, he doesn't really have a choice about it at this stage of the game. Down bottom, he's got double damage rune waiting for Admiral Bulldog. We'll see how quickly that Orchid can come out or if the Vortex could be a kill.
And he did jump almost straight away. And not from range, not from a position where Admiral Bulldog can see him. If he can cut through the tree line, which is rather difficult when the tree line doesn't exist once again. In effect, he's gonna jump backwards. Pycat already raising and taking out his creeps too. And then if he's had enough, he's just gonna TP back to base. Doesn't want a bar of it. And he would have been very much aware too, the Alliance, like, you've just taken out all the bottom towers, you've taken out the tier 1 tower in the mid. The next option, and the most logical one, take out the top tier 1, tier 2 tower, start securing the jungle of 4ASC, and cut off the Chen army lifeline. No way to get more creeps if you can't get into a jungle.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Dire's top tower. Yeah, the tower's gonna fall up top pretty easily here. They're just gonna continue to amount pressure, and I'm really honestly not a big fan of the Orchid here for Nemphy. If he got it faster and he could be working towards his next item, sure, but as it is, with only an Orchid, his life is entirely in the Chen's hands. Either Boogie saves him or he dies every fight.
Yep. There goes the tier 1 tower on bottom, so it's a trade-off, but they're going to lose their tier 2 on top. Pycat and Admiral Bulldog have a nice little army here, but at the same time, they're not going to bring in more help. Trixie, finger down, as well as being double-edged, and it was the damage from the Stampede which ended up killing him, and Storm Spirit jumps in, but he got Hex. The follow-up sun will be there from Matt. They wait the maximum amount of time. No hoof stop, 1 second off, but they don't even require it. Pike had already TP'd in, so did Admiral Bulldog. The Wrath of Nature bouncing around, but the rest of 4ASC are able to escape.
So this is kind of the moment of truth for Admiral Bulldog's build. He could just go for the kind of more tried and true Necronomicon with the Belt of Strength, or he could be going for that Silver Edge you're talking about. So really just kind of comes down to how much hero kill emphasis he wants over Split Push and Rat Dota.
I think at this point, man, it's got to be the Necro book, because you're still going up against a Storm Spirit. If you can burn just a little bit of that mana off, all good or none, you're still going to make sure that Storm Spirit is completely locked. Even the Lina, like, Laguna Blade isn't really the cheapest of all things that you can be using. And when you already have to spam out 255 worth of, like, of mana to a Light Strike Array and a Slave, you need, what, 3-4 hits and burn him down? And he may not even be able to ulti, let alone provide a second stun for the fight. It just looks too good in my mind to bypass it.
Now I'm actually looking at Matoma Man, and picking up the Sanjin Yasha here instead of the Mantis style means he's also vulnerable to Bulldog. I mean, he can quell his way out of the Sprout no matter what, but if they have multiple spells to lock him down, even in projectile sense, he has the Orchid to prevent that spin, so that could be a pretty big deal too. But for now, they're just gonna kill off the Chen Army. One more hit goes down, they only have the Wildwood left, and really that's nothing to fight with.
They just smoked too close. I know, Foria, so you're really considering running around the back, or if this is just a misclick, but they might have been considering looping around from behind. Looks like top lane, they're having some fun with the top of them. Mad's right behind him, Admiral Bulldog almost dying there, but looks like he'll end up surviving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just couldn't get a spell off. No Omni Slash because of the Orchid, and down he goes. So really good return from, of course, Mad rotating up there and getting the blink play, but it was kind of Bulldog with the Orchid to bait it out, so it all works out for him. And he'll get a Yules out of it. So really, I mean, yeah, the Lina picks up a Yules too, but this is one support with a Yules and a Blink Dagger, and this is one with just a Tranquil Yules. So very different net worth values between these two sides. And I do think if Four Anchors had gotten that smoke off successfully, they could have found a good, pretty good wraparound. The Aegis was expiring on the Shadow Fiend right within the next, like, 20 seconds, so they could have probably found a pretty good opening where the SF was a little bit overconfident, where Pycat was just slightly out of position, and that would have been a lot of comeback gold.
Yep. But for now, 4ASC, they're the ones that have to defend. The Wild Wing Army of the Chen is the only thing that's really slowing down Alliance on the top, but they're happy. They've taken all the outer towers. There's not much left really to speak of. Lode is getting closer and closer towards that Aghanim Scepter 2. He's now 700 gold away, roughly, from having that. So when you start bringing in an Aghanim's upgraded Centaur to the field, your Nature's Prophet's feeling happy as Larry. He's got his level 1 Necro book now done. And next Roshan spawns up in potentially 2 minutes roughly time. So you get a lot of time where Alliance can just play the cards right. Don't force anything up against 4ASC. Doing that could find themselves dying and giving momentum to a Storm Spirit. Instead, just keep the lanes controlled, keep the SF getting bigger. He's already got mana style, so they can't control it. Storm Spirit picks up an Orchid. Who really cares? He just mana styles back out of it. He gets a Scardy. He's got enough life he can tank up anybody. And then there really is no other care. They find Boogie at a position. One hit from the SF and the double edge from the Centaur. This now opens up the push again to come up high ground.
Yeah, and that's 400 gold until Lodo actually has Aghanim Scepter on top of his Blink and Force Staff. Like, despite being a Centaur, like the Initiator, not really a hard farmer, from the safe lane position, he's found 400 GPM, and he is rocking it. But we're going to see the pressure onto the Tier 3s, two Wild Wing Tornadoes trying to disrupt it, but even still, it's going to be some heavy siege damage while the Chen is down.
Yeah, especially when Bulldog brings level 2 Necro units to the front lines. So, looks like they get... They at least get rid of him.
Yeah. They burn Trixie, though. I mean, he's probably going to have to go back to Fountain before he can do anything. But it looks like they're going to disengage anyways.
It's almost like he's just posturing that he can stand here. But the Tier 2 tower's taking damage. I know Alliance are probably considering at this point that the only thing they really care about is taking racks. Once they do that, they feel like they've got all the advantage in the world, and Admiral Bulldog will have all the space in the world to control the side lanes. And in fact, here comes the TP's. Admiral Bulldog's the first one up. Orchid's over on the Storm Spirit. He's going to sprout him up as well. Just trying to control him. Fingers stunt. They need another raid here from Pycat. Oh, they just had that hex from Mad. But Tom O'Man's on the run out here. And once again, how many times has this happened where we've found him with not enough mana to go for the Omni Slash? Either way, he'll TP out to safety, so he's fine for the day.
Yeah, but he just couldn't do anything for the Storm there, and that was really frustrating. I figured at least they'd get it one for one on Bulldog, since they were essentially baiting the Storm Spirit up there. They knew that Bulldog wanted to go 1v1 the Storm. They had the Juggernaut just out of vision, ready to go, but in the end, they take the bait, and they get the kill, and it's just getting worse from here. Oh, the stun connects on Trixie.
That was a fraction of a second before it was going to end, but with the Sprout from Admiral Bulldog on the cliffside, he was looking for the Beastmaster. They're also looking for the Chen. I'm surprised that this situation could even happen. Look at the hillside on the top of the Dire Jungle.
Yeah.
Radiant Surf Ward next to Dire Sentry Ward.
Mm-hmm. Boogie was trying to deward it, and then he saw them approaching, so he tried to run up here, and Loda was right on top of him in 2 seconds flat, so just punishing that. I mean, you don't miss uphill anymore, but he didn't bring his Tango. Oh, he did bring Tangos. He didn't eat the ward. That's why it still remains.
Well, there goes your mid tower. Shadow Feet will take it. And just one bit of chip damage into the range racks, the one that won't regenerate on them. And they're backing up. Aghanim's is done for the Centaur. And that Weave is almost through a full duration. Alliance has so much armor at the moment, but the hilarious thing is, with this upgrade, they could potentially just run up. You don't no longer have to go through the three choke points. You can just come up through the sides and then Blink Dagger up.
I mean, they're so tanky right now. I'm actually like trying to think of the numbers of with the Weave at its max duration and the Stampede up, how long they could tank the Fountain right now. Like, they have just so much armor, so much resistance. They're going in with the smoke play. They'll get the jump on Trixie, and that's going to be a terrible way to start the fight.
Finger of Death also helps to make sure that he goes down at the very, very beginning. The mech comes off from the Chen, but there's no Hand of God available. He's isolated. Varlix, the Yule Scepter, goes up. He knows he's already dead. There's a triple kill for Pycat, and I'm fairly certain the GG call's going to come out. Loda, he's bringing actually the Omni Slashing Juggernaut back to Alliance by just walking with him with the Omni Slash on him. And this will be mid Rex. This should be bottom Rex. And it should actually be the GG call too.
Yeah. I like how Alliance built this game, though. Despite having, like, the 17,000 net worth advantage, they took a lesson from 6.83, and that's when you have that advantage, build to protect that advantage, and give no chance of comeback. With Pycat, he's got Lincoln's Manta Mechanism with a Dazzle and Centaur behind him. There's no way they could bring Pycat down. No way they could tap into that 18,000 net worth pinata.
We're going to
go for a last ditch, but there's no hope here.
Give it one last crack, man. Trixie might get a roar off and a 5 for once. But then in comes Loda. He does get the roar off over on the Centaur, but they're already right on top of him with the raids as well. The Shallow Grave keeping Loda alive. It is a 1-for-1 trade-off, but Matt's the only one to die so far. As 4 AOC will defend their bottom racks. But the Weave,
in with Stampede, I think.
Yeah, they could. Wrath of Nature still up too. So they would have had their bonus damage, but nah. Look, Admiral Bulldog's gonna use it and just gets the hell out.
Mm-hmm.
Like, wow, they really do want to kill off buildings. We get ourselves a 27-minute Desolator and a third core item, not to mention the support mech that's there.
So one thing that's really interesting enough for 684 is just looking at how valuable killing off the racks are nowadays. Like, if you actually look at the bounty increase, especially on the range racks.
Oh, he's coming. Storm Spirit. Not going for the full jump, though. But Aegis the Maul's are in the hands of Pycat and Loda. Whoa! He jumps up and then stampedes the rest of his team up the hillside. And that's what he was looking for. And they can't catch up to anybody else, and I think that just shows you also the fact you're getting used to this new patch. Varlix is in so much trouble with the Desolator effect plus the presence of the Dark Lord. They're going to lose this bottom racks. But yeah, I don't think Elias is really ready for that Aghanim Centaur.
Yeah, 4AC, they just don't even know what to do in that situation. Like, it's so good around the Roche Pit in particular, because terrain is a big limitation for that siege or counter siege, but going in there, they've got their everything up, Desolator, they've got their Solar Crest, and that Ags is just so damn good. So, we're going to see two lanes go down, and that's going to prompt the GG.
That it will. So, game number one, we'll get to go the way of Alliance. 4AC, kind of a hard road left to walk if they're going to force us to a third game and get that potential chance to play a best of three to get yourself qualified for the MLG joinDOTA Pro League LAN Finals, which is hosted for the first time at X Games. They had CSGO there last time, And this time around, they're like, you know what? Let's bring in some Dota 2. So it should be a fantastic LAN final. Hopefully, if you are going to be in America, you'll end up attending as well. If you haven't got your X Games tickets yet, I believe there are still some available that you can get for the Dota 2 area. It's the VIP stuff for the Dota 2 area, which I believe is available. So yeah, stay tuned. We'll be back after a short break for game number 2.